In the first part of this lecture, I have discussed how we're going to use Tor browser to access the content, especially the content of the surface web. So in this part, we will discuss how can we use Tor to provide the services in the dark web. So we move on to the place where we stop this lecture. So the dark web, Amazonian land. The dark web content basically hosted by the organizations and individuals in the places where no one will be able to trace their locations. So mainly we host those as Tor hidden services. In addition to the Tor, there are several other technologies such as Freenet, operated by different individuals and the public organization to host dark web content. The dark web, present bad guys to various businesses. Especially the bad people use dark web to communicate, to do various businesses. And sometimes the activists, whistleblowers, and some people, journalists especially, may use dark web to establish the communication in between or within their groups. So if you use Tor techniques to establish the dark web content, so it's we create a domain, call it as .onion, with some suffix. So that is a specific URL. Actually, it is kind of a hash value of a public key which used by this service. So in the Tor dark web websites, in order to host this Tor dark web website, first of all, we should create .onion domain. So you know, usually we obtain domain names from ICANN, and there are so many other top level domain name providers, but .onion domains are not provided by such organization. So those names generated by the service ourselves. So in the previous version, it has 16-bit characters. And now with the version 3, it has 56 characters. In the version 3.onion addresses. So this address is created by the, now it's created by the SHA3 an elliptic curve cryptography. The curve used 24519 curve is used as the elliptic curve to create those addresses. So in the first versions of Onion, use RSA, now it uses elliptic curves. And hashing they use is SHA before, now it's SHA-3. When you run the Tor service, that automatically generate address for you. So it is a hash value of your public key and some algorithms behind it. So when you create such addresses, it may not have human readable name. It is some characters. But in a minute you might see some organizations has created some human readable .onion addresses. In order to do that, they have to use considerable amount of resource to try out various public keys until they ended up with the human readable name or the name they are interested in. So in order to generate such, we need to spend a lot of computing power. But most of the people just created random.onion addresses for their service based on this, based on the public key. Okay, now let's have a look the technology or the theory or the protocol behind these Tor hidden services. So the idea is both want to run a web server or the service to the world. Alice and some people will access those service, but none of them will be able to trace or will be able to identify the location and the person who is running this service, unless otherwise he voluntarily reveal it. How that works? So assume Bob want to run such .onion service to the world. First of all, he should generate key pair. So based on his public key, he create an address, .onion address. After that, Bob establish an onion circuit with three random onion routers. So those three routers, we call it as introductory points of the Bob. So Bob tells his public key and the information about its introductory point to a public registry or a database. Basically, Bob tells his public key information about his introductory point and register his service. For example, xyz.onion into the databases. Directories, actually. Database means directories of the Tor. Tor directories knows about such introductory points and corresponding onion services. Then, if Alice got to know about this interesting onion service, through a dark web search engine or through some other means. So then Alice wants to load the page from the book. So then what Alice do? Alice establish. Actually, Alice gets the information about introductory points from the directory service and randomly pick one introductory point among the three. So then Alice establishes Tor circuit to a random onion router and inform about his willingness to talk to the Bob. So the onion router Alice talks to call it as Randover's point. Alice tells about his one-time secret that is a part of his DeFeldman public key. So the two use DeFeldman protocol to establish the keys. So Alice part of the DeFeldman public key that call it as secret. Alice tells to the introductory point. Actually, he creates a Tor circuit to Randover points. That means random onion router. Then, what Alice do? Alice tells the information about its Randover point to the introductory point. Telling that, please pass this information to the Bob. In other words, Alice tells one of the introductory point, that is Tor circuit, Tor router. Hello, I'm Alice, who wants to talk to the Bob's service. And for that, I prefer to go through a Randover point. This particular Randover point by giving the information about Alice Randover point. So this introductory point knows about the Bob's. Actually, it's not his introductory point don't know about anything about the Bob. Introductory point knows how to contact the Bob's, because Bob has established a circuit to the introductory points. So the circuit already introduced, those green lines are circuits. It's not direct connections, it's a Tor circuits. That means it comes through three points. This is kind of exit node of the circuit. Introductory point is somehow the exit node of the Tor circuit. So then this introductory point knows about how to pass this message to the Bob's. That means how to pass the information about Randover point to the Bob. So Bob gets about it. This message saying, there is a person who wants to talk to you via this particular Randover point. Then when it gets that information, the Bob sends part of his public key where he wants to establish the connection to the Randover point. Randover point pass the part of this Alice sacred to the Bob. So then Bob can Alice establish the shard sacred. So Alice then, as usual, create the Tor circuits from his computer to the computer of Bob's and radar point bridge the traffic. So in typical situation, in Alice, between Alice and radar point, there will be a Tor circuit that is 3-hop, and then Bob also talks to radar point through the Tor circuit. So it may be then some relays here as well. The radar point here who connect Alice and Bob together have no idea about the place of the Bob as well as space of the Alice. They just pass the, this relays just pass the encrypted information in between these two nodes. That's how this Tor works. So if I can repeat that. So first of all, Bob pick random introductory points, establishing Tor circuits to that. So these green lines are Tor circuits, not the connections. And those information about introductory point and the information about public key of the Bob published on the directory servers together with his service address, that is hash of the public key. So the people who wants to talk should get that address and the corresponding introductory point from the directories. And parallel to that, people who want to access such service should establish the Tor circuit to a random node called random point. And if Alice wants to talk to one of these services, so Alice should inform about his random point to one of the randomly picked introductory point of the Bob. So that passes this information to the Bob. Then Bob's using that information connect to the random point through the Tor circuit. So again, this is a Tor circuit, not the connection. And then Alice also connect to this and do a point through the Tor circuit. So this relay then bridge these two traffics together. So it creates entirely anonymous service. These two people have no idea about each other. So this is service which offers by this person called it as hidden service or Tor hidden service. Now let's have a look how to create such Tor hidden service in a minute. In order to create a Tor hidden service, you should install a Tor proxy in your computer. So it's not a Tor browser bundle, it's a Tor proxy. So when you install that, there is a configuration file called torrc. So it's usually in the Linux based system and the Mac. It is located in the user local etc torrc directory. At the default, it has some sample torrc files where you can rename one of them to torrc. Then you have to set the permission to this directory Tor in a way no one can access that, because in that directory we're going to store the public and private keys of this service. So in this Tor service configuration file, there is a line where we can tell about this information. So using this hidden service directory, we tell where we're going to store our keys. And then hidden service port, we tells about port and the IP address we're going to match this for. So for example, in this line we say, so hidden service port is port 80. So port 80, we go provide this hidden service information to the public. So, but in the local machine that map to the port 88. That means in the local machine, you need to set up a web server which runs at port number 88. So for demonstration purposes, I will just use this simple Python command to start a web server at this port. And then using torc file, I map that to my hidden service. And that's it. So then you can access this hidden service through the Tor browser. Let me demonstrate it in a minute. So this is a very simple Tor hidden service. If you want to run a permanent Tor hidden service, obviously you need to set it at the cloud or some server. And then there you can, you should run a web server which is listening to the local port, and then you should run a Tor there, and then forward request comes to Tor to this web server. Then Tor proxy will fit the web server from the local machine and establish such service connection to the requested parties. As I said, so there is a file called etc user local etc Tor directory. There's a file called torc. So when you see that, there are several configurations lines. So an important line is this one. So you see it's uncommented. In these two lines, we say our hidden service directory is user local etc Tor, and hidden service port is port 80, mapped to 127.0.0.1.8080. So our web server then should run in this local IP on the port number 8088. So you can run one Tor proxy to the multiple hidden services. There you have to uncommit different directories. So for example, I am running in a different other hidden service at port 8080. This is port 80. Port 8080 that map to a port 80 back. So then I need to have a server running on the port 80, which listen or map to a port 80. So my keys are stored in etc Tor test directory. So then there are two directories. This directory hosts the keys of the first hidden service. This directory keeps the keys of the second hidden service. So I can have one hidden service mapping to different directories. So let me show you the content of that directory. So I say running ls command. It has several files, as you see. This is configuration file, and these are the default and sample Tor files which comes installed. You should rename one of these files to torc and then do this configuration which I mentioned. So after that, you just start the Tor. When you start the Tor first time, it's automatically generate public and private keys. So those keys are now elliptical 25 519 curve, elliptic curves, public key, and this is EC private key. And then we take the SHA-3 hash out of this public key. So that is my hostname that saved here. So this file may contain the people who have access to, authorized to access that. If you don't have any authorization setups, anyone can access this service through the Tor if they know this hostname. Hostnaming as of the public key. So when you look at this hostname, sorry, it's under the local etc Tor hostname. You see, this is my hidden service address or the Dot Onion address to access that. Let me copy this address. Now I need to create a local web server. I will take the another prompt here and then I go to some place. I want to host this in service. So I go to a directory called Tor here. So this is empty. There is a file called test anyway. So I will maybe create a place where I should store my web content, HTML. So maybe I create a directory called HTML. Put a file or index.html in that directory. Say this is my just a simple file. It has now this file. So under HTML index. Okay. Now what I do is basically start this Python server, simple Python server, giving this HTML directory as the local directory. So I start a simple Python based HTTP server which listen to the port. So when you go to the any browser and then go to this web address, you see this is loaded. So when you put that, so our hidden service address here, this, so when you go that here and put it there, there are no such sites. So regular browsers cannot reach that. Okay. Now web server is running local. We need to connect it to the global now. For that, what you have to do is we just run the Tor. So when you run the Tor browser, it basically start connect the three introductory point, establish Tor service to three introductory points and announce that service to the world. So what is the service they announce? This service which I created here. So if I want to access now that, so I just start a Tor browser and put that dot onion address. So this, my Tor browser then establish introductory service, sorry, Renova connection, Tor connection to Renova node or the Renova point, and then establish the Tor connection to my local service. So when you have a look on that, you see this browser, go to the guard service, Canada, the Poland. This Poland web server here, Poland proxy server here, works as my Renova point. Then this hidden service onion has set up three relays, and this one is my set up a Tor circuit. And this one is the exit of that circuit, that is final Renova point. interactive, which picked by this browser. So in these two, after browser inform about he wants to access this hidden service to one of these relays through this circuit. So it informs about that and then communicates goes, as you see, through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 relays. Because it's two different Tor circuits, one from one direction from the web server to the Tor network. Other one is from the other direction from web browser to the Tor network. So this communication is totally anonymous. No one will be able to find it out, the location of this web server, because it's a web server running at local. And that web server talks to the Tor network via the Tor proxy running on the same server. So I am demonstrating it in the local machine by running a simple local web server. If you want to actually deploy a hidden service to the world, obviously you need to deploy it in a cloud. But no one will see your IP address of the cloud, because your web server, you set it up this in the cloud server as a local server. And then you run a Tor to connect this local web server to the network through this Tor circuits. For the place where you run this Tor is also invisible to the world. So because of that, no one will be able to find it out where you are running this hidden service. So as you see, so this hidden service here can be accessed from the anywhere from the world. So as I am running it in my local machine at the moment. So these hidden services cannot access through the regular browsers. So for example, so let's see, I shut down this web server here. So then after that, if I try to get that, say it's unable to reach because the service is not running anymore. By the way, if you want to access the Tor services through your regular browsers, that can be done via the SOC servers. So you can set it up the SOC to listen to port number 9050. Yeah. How do you do that? For example, if you want, let's say, you see this hidden service is not loadable now in this. So what you could do, you can set the preference and change your SOC address. Maybe it is an advanced system settings. And you go to the system settings and change your, put your SOC server as 9050. Right. So after you set it up, now your browser talks to the Tor proxy running here. So I restart my web server. So that proxy now then connect to this. So now your regular Chrome browser can even access my Tor service for you. Let's say I say reload. Maybe I try whether the Tor works. I think check. Project.org. So I'd say no, you're not using Tor. So there is an issue. Let's see. Edit preferences. And advanced. system settings, and my, okay, it is not set. My socks proxy is this, IP address is this. Then I say okay, and then I say apply. So somehow it was, well, I didn't set it properly in the last step. Now it set it, and then I try to check that whether I'm communicating through the Tor proxy by typing check Tor proxy. Yes, now it's done. Now you see my regular Chrome browser use Tor. So through the socks proxy server. So because of that, if I want to visit now my website in service address, we can get it. So what would be the address? Let's see, I copied it perhaps, no. It's port number, maybe we need to get the address. Somewhere I cat it, you remember? Here, the address. So now I want to visit that in service. Yes, you got it. So now it's Chrome browser, not the Tor browser. Obviously, Tor browser can also reach that same service. So here it's reached through Poland, and here it reached. I don't see it's, no, it's not showing it here because it's a regular browser. But that goes to the Tor proxy and then to this website. Right, so that's how you can set it up a written web service. When you check the functionality of that, actually it's encrypted. Virtual circuit established dynamically in between browsers and the web servers running in various locations in the world. So since it's go through different hops, and they do encryption hop by hop. So obviously there is a latency. Some Tor onion routers exchange some dummy traffic to show that, or to kind of make difficult to some people to do traffic analysis. However, usually when you access to networks, still our DNS resource goes through the regular network. So for example, if you type some domain name in the browser, so that maps to the IP through the regular network by the regular DNS service. After these Tor clients get that IP, it's request that IP address through the Tor service. Because of that, if someone wants, OISP wants, they can block the Tor. Plus they can kind of get information that this browser resolved this address. So if you don't want to see that, there is a way of resolving DNS also through the Tor, but by default it is not happening. But just resolving DNS may not tell us exactly we access this or not. So because of that, we still see. Plus, the destination servers may not get any information about us because this address is resolved by the separate DNS servers. The other thing is traffic analysis type of things. So to some extent, people can monitor the traffic goes through these Tor networks. And sometimes, occasionally, they may see your identity. So if you carefully have a look on the Tor circuits, by default, there are three onion routers. We call it as entry guard, middle, and the exit. So you notice that. Default configuration is three. If you want to get more, you can do so, but adding more will add more latency to a system. So let's say some malicious attacker has control, get control to the guard node, and you connect it to the guard node where some government agency or a kind of hacker controlling it, because you have no idea about the person who is controlling this guard node. The Tor get it from the directory servers. Maybe some of the nodes Tor get that to this directory server is compromised. Then what happens? When you request a page destination, so it's encrypted three times and passed to the guard nodes. So guard nodes have no idea about your destination, even though someone controls it, because guard don't have access of the other keys. However, guard see the source. Guard nodes see you connected or you intend to connect some website through the Tor, but guard nodes have no idea about your destination. Similarly, if someone, malicious person, has controls about any of these middle nodes, you don't need to worry about compromisation of the middle node. May not be able to compromise anything, because all they do is just relaying the traffic. So they have no idea about source or the destination. But your exit node get compromised, then he has idea about destination, because he knows where to Tor. So here he knows the source and destination unknown. Here basically source is unknown, but destination is known. This exit guard knows the exit node, knows the destination, but they don't know about the source. So, problem is this situation. If guard node and the exit node both compromised by the same agency or the same hacker, then obviously they will know about the source as well as the destination. That means it's your identity is revealed. Can this happen? Usually in the Tor network, there are over 6,000 Tor onion routers are running, I guess. So most of those routers basically run by the trusted volunteers. Assume that we have such n total relays active on the moment. So due to some attacks, let's say m of them are compromised or controlled by the attack. Then there is a n over m chance probability of first node or the guard node compromise. If there are 2 out of 100 nodes get compromised, there's 2% of chance when someone pick a guard node, that node may be a compromised node. Similarly, the chance of getting a compromise exit node is this n minus 1 or n minus 1. So if both nodes get compromised, is multiplication of this. So it's roughly the probability of n over m squared. There's a small chance someone will end up with two compromised nodes at the end, at the exit parcel as at the entry. So if m get increased, obviously there's more chance that might happen. So in the over the time, if randomly we change those nodes, then there is a more probability that may happen than some instance. So that because we are not advising to change the entry node or the guard node in short lifetime periods. So the tau default circuit lifetime is kind of 10 minutes. Because of this situation, we are not advised to have or change the guard node. So we keep fixed guard node and change the rest of the nodes. That's what we do. So we change the guard node after a long period of time. So we do that to make sure someone will not end up with compromised guard and exit node at the same time. So how do we pick those or information about Tor relays and in service? Actually, we are taking them from trusted directory servers, which is set it up worldwide. These list of known relays are available to the Tor browsers as well as Tor relays. So among this list of trusted known, we actually pick the guard nodes. So we are picking them not randomly. We are picking them based on the available bandwidth and some other parameters. Right. So we had now very good introduction about Tor browsers and Tor hidden service. So who and why we use this Tor? So most of the law enforcement users are using Tor to visit target websites without revealing their IDs. So otherwise, targets may see some law enforcement or the police or the government targeting them. So because of that, the legal people or the intelligent gathering, intelligent information gathering people or SIM people usually use Tor. Or the forensic analysis usually use Tor to reach their destinations. So then the destinations may not get the source IPs. And obviously whistleblowers use Tor to anonymously contact the news organizations and the media organizations and provide those secret information to them. So those media organizations may never see then the people who provide those information. So then they are safe. And maybe listen to
or the people who fight against regimes used to hide their identity. Especially these people use store service to disseminate the information without revealing their identity. Obviously, the bad guys use store to commit crimes. They are running different marketplaces and different computer underworld services via Tor. So since this Tor, together with cryptocurrency, is the way bad guys use to commit crimes and make money. So I have created separate videos on cryptocurrencies. So here we discuss the Tor. So in currently over 6,000 Tor ways are active. All of them are run by volunteers. Roughly 6 million users, 500K to 6 million active users are using Tor at the moment. But people suspect that some of these 6,000 relays are controlled by intelligence agencies or hackers or some countries or fields intelligence agencies of the countries. We never know. But anyway, Tor is the largest popular darknet technology. Who you can get about those information by visiting matrixtorproject.org. And someone did very nice traffic analysis over Tor actually 4 years ago. I got this figure from the website called Torflow. There, it's noticed that the most of the Tor traffic goes in between Europe and the US. The rest of the world is very, they are using Tor is very limited. But in between these two continents, there were a lot of activities going on. Maybe criminal activities, maybe intelligence gathering activities, we never know. Obviously, in the last 4 years, it was definitely changed. I guess these traffic patterns are completely different right now. Somebody has to do analysis again to see what is the situation right now. Who are the people using this Tor hidden service? I said bad guys. Obviously, not only bad guys, good guys also use Tor hidden services. So you can visit this wiki page to see some pages, some addresses of Tor hidden service. Interestingly, social media network like Facebook has Tor hidden service. BBC has Tor hidden service. Why those media agencies and the social networking websites running Tor hidden web service? Because time to time, various regimes in the world, they banned those services. So then their end users may not be able to reach those. Their web services running on the ClearNet. So, firewalls running by the regimes will block accessing those ClearNet websites of these media agencies and the social networking websites. Because of that, they are running their web servers also in the darknet to provide the service of the people who are using this darknet. In addition to that, I said if you want to search something over the Tor network, the default search engine is DuckDuckGo. Google blocks it. When you use to Google over the Tor, you may get a lot of pop-ups asking to verify whether you are human.
So you don't need to suffer with Google. Use DuckDuckGo, that is privacy preserving search engine where they don't store any of your search information. And also there is a hidden wikis managed by Tor users or the dark web users, where you see some content we are not influenced by some governments. So this is the onion address of Facebook. So by visiting that, you can access the same Facebook. As you see, this onion address has the human readable name, Facebook co-WWI. How did they get this address? They had to spend a lot of time and energy, obviously, to find it out public key which created this hash. So they might get it using some tools. So they keep to that onion address. And then BBC runs it, hidden service, BBC News, B3, whatever this is the onion address of the BBC. And this is a Tor hidden wiki. There is a hidden version of the wiki in the darknet where you can reach that address. And there are marketplaces where you can buy a lot of things, especially weapons, drugs, and a lot of bad things happens. Even you can hire murders, hire people to do murdering and things like that. So they are the place where bad people meet. So they are the place also usually watching by the police and the intelligence agencies. So if you want to search about or search on these darknets, the onion DuckDuckGo is the search engine. That DuckDuckGo also has the instance which running at the darknet. So this is the address of this darknet version of DuckDuckGo. So it's available in the clearnet, as I said. So some companies like Facebook, DuckDuckGo, BBC, like news services, they are having clearnet version as well as darknet versions. So you may notice it. So there is other search engines like Noctevil, Ahimyo. So they using that, you can search only on onions. So when you use DuckDuck search, it's give the results from onion website as well as clearnet websites. If you use this, the usual results comes from onion websites. So now it's up to you to explore the darknet and gather the information and find it out how it works. So maybe I will show before I wrap up, I will show those instances. So maybe this is facebook.onion. So you type that, I think you don't need www. So you go to Tor, or you can go to my now Chrome browser, because it's go through the Tor proxy. So it should load the Facebook. So similarly, I can visit. Let's see whether it's coming from, or if not, maybe I type it on the Tor browser. It comes here. You see, it's Facebook, which loads darknet version of the Facebook, same Facebook instance. You can use your regular Facebook accounts to log in to this page and you get access to our content. If some, for why they are running it, as I said, so if some regimes blocks that, so still you can go through the tool to their PNet website as well as their darknet website. So then BBC runs the darknet version of their website. So then for the journalist, so using these websites, whistleblowers and other people can report some news items and provide some feedbacks to the BBC. Plus people in some other countries which banned the BBC website still can reach and get the information from the darknet. So similarly, so there is a dark wiki you can visit and see, and there are marketplaces. So I'm not going to detail, but I just show you there are marketplaces where people buy and sell bad things. So you like eBay and Alibaba. So that's the ClearNet marketplaces. There are several marketplaces unknown to the good people where the bad people may do a lot of business. So this one of such marketplaces, maybe at the moment it may be down, it seems. Or I try with this store whether I could reach that. Yeah, now I copy this URL, copy it, and type it at the top also to see whether I can reach that. Right. Similarly, this is the onion address or the darknet address of the DuckDuckGo. So I can reach that. In the Tor browser, yes, you see. So this is a kind of underworld market which runs in the darknet. So the DuckDuckGo also has the hidden version where you can see some the darknet as well as the ClearNet website. So if some country banned DuckDuckGo, you can still reach their darknet website. Then, as I said, there is a darknet version of search engines. The simplest one is this, I think. So you can reach them and search some services. So they returns only the onion addresses. So you can query. Maybe I query about Sri Lanka. So they will send some addresses about some activities. So you see, most of them are onion addresses. So you see, they are kind of pornography, underworld websites, and then weapon sites, weapon selling sites, and so on. Similarly, this is another search engine which is available to search on onion services. So you, when you visit so such websites, you have to be very careful because you are dealing with bad people. So you see there are websites which do various bad things. So some of them work, some of them are not working, but it's up to you to explore. So with these two lectures, I have shown you the dark web and how to access it, how to search it. So if you are OSIN perspective, so you might collect a lot of information through that for your investigations. So if you are forensic experts, again, it's interesting on the darknet because there's a lot of information which is not available to available in the clear net, which is available in the darknet. Okay, I think that's the end of this lecture. So I will create a separate video where I demonstrate how to run a Toyin service using Docker. So by getting some cloud instance, just fetching the Docker scripts or the Docker images, you can just upload darknet service or the Toyin service in this minute. I will create that on a separate video. So thank you very much for the listening so far. So some of these content I have taken images and the content for those two lectures I have taken from the Tor project. So I would like to acknowledge that at the end. Okay, thank you for listening so far.